This is the home front that really brought the inside and the outside together. A room that was practically in the garden.
It's gonna be fine. Trust me, I'm getting wet.
And this is the couple who tried to bring the two of us together.
Their relationship has now blossomed, hasn't it?
Yes.
They don't talk at all now.
Design and designers from the inside out.
I like working with you, but I've absolutely no interest in designing with you.
Homefront continues Wednesday at 8 o'clock on BBC Two.
Hey, come here.
Hey.
No, listen to me, right?
Can I tell you something? Do you know what you're paid for? You're paid to battle cages.
No, you shut up before and the bushes get away. What's the matter with you?
You're on your own now. You're free. No divorce, no alimony, no kids. You could be on something great here.
I am the bear. I'm Dexter.
Hello, kids.
He's just a bloke they hired in to stand behind me. Just an out-of-work actor.
You've upset my daughter now, mate. You happy?
Danny, what have you done to your face?
Is it a humour? Is it a drama? It's a humour drama.
Come on, Charlie, stop mucking about.
Happiness starts Tuesday, the 20th of March, on BBC Two.
Now, darling, you really just want to rip the basil, don't chop it.
We'll do anything for food on BBC Two.
Now on BBC Two, Newsnight and Newsnight Review with Jeremy Vine and Mark Lawson.
I did not lie, I did not deceive, and I did not set out to mislead.
Mr. Mandelson has something to celebrate. But if he wasn't rotten, why did he have to go in the first place? Good evening. Those who expected the Hammond inquiry to coat the events surrounding Mr. Mandelson's resignation in thick white paint felt justified today. Peter Mandelson was cleared of lying, and he and Keith Vaz were defended against the charge that they used improper pressure to obtain the wealthy Hinduja brothers their passports. We'll discuss what the report says and what it misses out.
And on Newsnight Review at 11, Ian Hislop, Jermaine Greer and Echo Eschen join me to discuss The Week in Culture, a novelist's vision of America from Eisenhower to Bush too, that infamous inmates in TV's Celebrity Big Brother, and the art of licking your rivals in the dog owner movie Best in Show.
For Mr. Mandelson, a day of vindication that must have felt bittersweet. The Hammond inquiry cleared the former Northern Ireland Secretary of impropriety in the Hinduja passport affair, but in doing so it added to the sense among Mr. Mandelson's allies that he should not have been pitchforked out of the government in the first place. He was forced to quit because he'd given conflicting accounts of a telephone call to Mike O'Brien at the Home Office, discrepancies which had fed through into statements made by the Prime Minister's press secretary, Alistair Campbell. But today, Sir Anthony Hammond wrote it all off as a muddle. Let's go through the findings. The Hammond conclusions are almost entirely positive. The applications for naturalisation of the Hindujas were handled properly, Sir Anthony says. No improper pressure was brought to bear by any minister. There was no evidence of any improper relationship between Mr. Mandelson and the Hindujas, and no evidence of any improper relationship between Keith Vaz and the Hindujas. There was also no evidence of any connection between the money that went to the dome and the Hinduja passport applications. The report concludes it is likely that Mr. Mandelson spoke directly to Mr. O'Brien. But Mr. Mandelson's belief that he had not had a telephone conversation with Mike O'Brien was honestly held. There are two minor criticisms. Record keeping in the private offices involved was, in some respects, unsatisfactory. And the processing of the passport applications by the Home Office could have been improved. So the question marks have moved now from Peter Mandelson to number 10. Distilled, the 73 pages of the Hammond report suggest panic took over when the inconsistencies in the various accounts of what had happened could not immediately be explained, and Mr. Mandelson paid with his job. The report makes mention of what others called the kangaroo court, On the day of the resignation, there was a 9 a.m. meeting in Mr. Blair's flat involving the head of the civil service as well as the Lord Chancellor and five others. Our political correspondent, Laura Trevelyan, reports.
There is no doubt, by his own admission, that he told an untruth.
He resigned because he wasn't accurate, didn't speak the truth.
I think Peter accepts that his career's in tatters.
Only 6 weeks ago, cabinet ministers queued up to trample on Peter Mandelson's reputation. Yet today he's exonerated, and Downing Street say he's left without a stain on his character. Cold comfort for the man learning to live without his cabinet career.
In sum, Sir Anthony's report establishes that I did not lie, I did not deceive, and I did not set out to mislead. I am grateful to Sir Anthony for clearing my name and restoring my reputation. This was indeed a muddle rather than a misrepresentation. And I would like to say how much I regret the part I played in creating this muddle.
That muddle resulted in a 70-page report from Sir Anthony Hammond, QC. The Downing Street spokesman, who faced political journalists this morning to respond to this report, had a difficult task. Keith Vaz, the Europe Minister, and Peter Mandelson are both cleared by this, but Mr. Vaz is still in government, while Peter Mandelson is out in the cold. It's a tricky one to defend, and the spokesman struggled, saying in the end that the government didn't want to go over old ground. Trouble is, the Hammond report does provide new details about Mr. Mandelson's resignation. There's a letter from Sir Richard Wilson, the head of the Home Civil Service, to Number 10, dated January 23rd, the day before the resignation. Sir Richard says, "I suggest the Prime Minister and Number 10 should not get too involved in this. No one has produced a shred of evidence that anything improper took place." But the Prime Minister ignored Sir Richard Wilson's advice. Why? Because of a disputed phone call between Mr. Mandelson and the Home Office Minister, Mike O'Brien, about the passport application of S.P. Hinduja, a wealthy Indian businessman who offered money to the Millennium Dome. Responding to an inquiry from the Observer newspaper about his involvement in this application, Mr. Mandelson said it was handled by his private office. Mike O'Brien, though, remembered a phone call.
"I feel very sad that I had to make it very clear that that conversation had occurred, and that as a result, it seems that Peter has left the government."
Jack Straw, the Home Secretary, called Mr. Mandelson to remind him this call had taken place. According to the Hammond inquiry, on the evening of January 23rd, Mrs. Straw told the Prime Minister he'd spoken to Mr. Mandelson on two occasions. While Sir Anthony Hammond accepts that Mr. Mandelson cannot recollect the Mike O'Brien call, Downing Street were not so generous. The Prime Minister called Mr. Mandelson three times on the eve of his resignation, but clearly wasn't satisfied with the answers he received.
"The Prime Minister has spoken for the entire government, and I don't need to add to that."
Mr. Campbell, the Prime Minister's official spokesman, and, say, Mr. Mandelson's allies, knife-wielder-in-chief, wasn't giving much away today. But the Hammond inquiry reveals that on the morning of Wednesday, January 24th, a powerful group of eight, including the Lord Chancellor Derry Irvine, gathered in Downing Street to decide Mr. Mandelson's fate.
"Nobody's going to go to the courts about this, but yes, I mean, in the context of employment in the civil field, an employee in such circumstances very probably would have a case for constructive dismissal."
The real reason Peter Mandelson was forced out of government has nothing to do with this report, but everything to do with, as one minister put it, his previous convictions. Mr. Mandelson's behaviour under pressure rang alarm bells in Downing Street, who wondered if he was concealing something, as he had done over his infamous home loan affair. Peter's credit, as one ally of the Prime Minister put it to me, finally ran dry. But already there's talk of a second Mandelson comeback. Well, Peter has made it. The Prime Minister was quick to pay tribute to his old friend's skills today.
"I do believe him to be a person of immense ability and indeed integrity. And I do say to people right at the very beginning, I said this was a tragic case. And I said that I believed he would be cleared of any impropriety. And I'm very pleased for his sake that he has been. And I hope he's able now to get on and rebuild his life, because he is someone of great ability with a lot to give."
But others are less keen on Mr. Mandelson's abilities.
With the benefit of hindsight, I think it was a mistake to bring Peter back at that time. We've all paid the price for that because obviously the government has been through a difficult period. I don't think it's right for Peter to come back for the immediate future. You can never say never, but if you look at the idea of revolving doors, then you always get worried that those doors don't stop and people come back in, and that is, I think, by its very nature, a mistake.
If you read the main body of Sir Anthony Hammond's report, then it's all muddle and confusion, a typical Whitehall farce. But if you read the fine print of the report, in particular the annexes at the back, then a different picture emerges. For example, there was concern about the Hindujas in Whitehall as far back as 1991.
It shouldn't have happened. All sorts of alarm bells should have been ringing as a result of the allegations against the Hinduja brothers in India, that you treat this thing with special care and special attention.
In the 1980s, the Hinduja brothers were under suspicion for allegedly accepting kickbacks as a result of an arms deal between the Swedish company Bofors and the Indian government. In 1991, the Home Office refused the Hinduja brothers' British passports, saying privately, in view of the Bofors allegations, it could be difficult to say the Hindujas met the requirement to be of good character. Then, in 1996, the Foreign Office said, at the very least, the Hinduja brothers can be said to have sailed close to the wind. In January 1998, the Indian authorities contacted the Guernsey Attorney General via the Home Office regarding Guernsey bank accounts which they suspected were used to deposit corrupt payments relating to the Bofors contract. Both GP and SP Hinduja were mentioned among those being investigated, yet Home Office immigration officials failed to notice. The brothers offered to fund the dome in 1998, and that August the Home Office said they would be inclined to look favourably on a passport application from SP Hinduja. Mr Hinduja applied for that passport in October 98 and received it 6 months later. Jack Straw told the Prime Minister it's possible the case had been prioritised because of inquiries from a Home Office minister.
There seems to be a failure of communication somewhere in the government. I'm perfectly sure that the British High Commission in New Delhi was well aware of the facts about the Bofors scandal, about the Hinduja brothers. But somewhere along the line, the vital information seems to have been filtered out. Maybe it didn't reach the Home Office. It obviously didn't reach Downing Street. There are questions here that need to be answered and are simply not answered in the Hammond inquiry.
In his brief report, Sir Anthony Hammond has done little to dispel the perception that connections can result in a fast-track passport application.
Laura Trevelyan reporting there. Well, we're joined now by Lord Hattersley, former Labour deputy leader, also by Norman Baker, the Liberal Democrat whose question helped bring down Mr Mandelson, and by Anne Widdecombe, the Shadow Home Secretary. Mr Baker, in the light of events today and what this report says, are you now going to let these matters drop?
Well, unfortunately, the report only shows us one corner of the jigsaw. They were very narrow terms of reference, and Sir Anthony Hammond's kept well within those terms. The key question, unanswered, is how it can be that the Hinduja brothers, whom very few have heard of until recently, were able over a period of years to gain access at the highest level to politicians of both Labour and Conservative parties in this government and the previous government, while the security services were aware of serious allegations against them in India to do with the Bofors arms scandal.
That is sort of tackled, isn't it? Because Sir Anthony Hammond says that the applications for naturalisation were handled properly and within established criteria, so he didn't have a problem with them.
Well, I find that a little odd, actually, because in 1991 they were rejected because, apart from anything else, over a question mark over the good character eligibility criterion, and yet the character of the Hindujas, if anything, was potentially worse when subsequently they were granted their passports in record quick time.
Anne Widdecombe, do you accept that today Mr Mandelson was cleared of lying?
What I do find extraordinary is that if you look in the main body of the report, quite regardless of whether there was any connection between the dome cash and the granting of passports, there is still an extraordinary amount of ministerial intervention. We have Mike O'Brien, that's the Home Office Minister. We have his office saying that he's keen to take a more positive attitude towards citizenship, asking if the Hindujas might benefit from that, and then adding in parenthesis, but oh, by the way, we haven't even got an application in from them yet. And again, another memo suggesting that Jack Straw wanted the application dealt with, and I quote, helpfully.
But do you now, accept, Anne Widdecombe, that today Mr. Mandelson was cleared of lying?
I'll come to that. What I do want to say is this, because I don't want this overlooked, because I think it's crucial, that the degree of ministerial intervention was beyond anything that I would have expected, and I have actually been in the Home Office. As far as Mr. Mandelson goes, if he hasn't told any lies, and if he's done nothing wrong, then why on earth did he have to resign? What is going on in this government?
Roy Hattersley, what is the answer to that?
The answer is very simple. He resigned for two reasons, or had to resign for two reasons. The first is, over a long period, Mr. Mandelson has been trouble. Mr. Mandelson is a high wire act who falls off too often. And the Prime Minister, understandably, got agitated, perhaps even irritated, about the number of little coarse celebs in which a cabinet minister was involved. The other reason, and it's a good fault in the Prime Minister, is the Prime Minister wanted to be whiter than white. You can imagine what Anne Widdecombe would have said if this allegation had hung over the government for 6 months and Mandelson remained in post. What the report now reveals is on the technicalities of the thing, the lies. I mean, Mandelson's offence is nothing like, for example, David Willetts, the Tory minister who had to resign for lying to his elect committee, writing the Tory manifesto.
The report clears him
off. Mr. Mandelson, and we should not for a moment doubt that.
But the report clears him on the lie, in inverted commas, and therefore surely invalidates your first point.
No, because he's trouble, because he gave an answer which resulted in another minister being less than accurate and unintentionally, inadvertently with the House of Commons. You've got to have ministers who, by this preoccupation with high profile, involving themselves in everything, doing all sorts of things outside their remit, cause the government trouble. You can't have things that divert the government from its real priorities. You can't have distractions. And that's what Peter Mandelson has become.
Norman Baker, another point that you've been making today has, in a sense, also been answered by the report, which is the speed at which the passport was granted. Now, Sir Anthony Hammond looked at that, and he said it was within the range. It was as fast as another, say, 5% of passports have been granted. So he wasn't very troubled by it.
Well, it's very odd that the top 5% of passport applications in terms of speed includes one which deals with people from India who have got files on them held by MI6, doubting their character, relaying information about potential involvement with an arms scandal, and where a previous refusal has taken place. I would have thought that's the reason for slowing matters down rather than speeding them up.
Anne Widdecombe?
Yes, I mean, I don't think you can just say, oh, this was within the range. Because there were terribly serious issues surrounding the Hinduja brothers, issues which had caused the previous government to refuse a nationality application.
But basically, Anne Widdecombe, you don't accept large chunks of this report, then?
What I'm saying is that if you look at the main body of the report and closely at the text, it is possible to come from rather different conclusions, or to some different conclusions.
All right, what about this crucial one, 2.2, in the summary of conclusions? He says no improper pressure was brought to bear by any minister in respect to these passport applications.
I really don't think that is sustainable when you look at the memoranda that he actually annexes to his report, in which you've got intervention after intervention. Officials must have felt that ministers wanted a particular result and must have felt under pressure to give it.
And that is a worry, Roy Hedges, isn't it? There's so much traffic going on with this application.
I think the two worries in the report, I don't think they're those that Anne Widdecombe, who wishes to wound but doesn't actually accuse the report of being dishonest. I don't think they're the worries that she's dealing with. I think there are two worries. The first is that how this family can have had so much contact with government, not simply the Labour government, but we've all seen the big photographs of the Hinduja brothers with Mr. Haig, with previous Prime Ministers, with Mrs. Thatcher. Immensely worrying that this sort of person can seem to get into the levels of government, the top levels of government, with any administration. Very worrying.
Well, that's an indictment, isn't it?
The second problem is that, in a sense, the normal procedures were, according to report, followed. The head of the department said that he always looked after high-profile cases. And because he looked after high-profile cases, high-profile cases were invariably dealt with more quickly. Now, it seems to me an unacceptable level of civil liberties if high-profile cases applying for British nationality are, by definition, dealt with more quickly than the general.
You're troubled by some of the findings?
I'm certainly troubled. I'm not troubled by the findings. I'm troubled by what the findings reveal. I don't for a moment doubt the accuracy of the report and its conclusions. But some of the workings of the Home Office Nationality Department which certainly worried me when Ms. Whittaker was in charge of these things, worries me still, and I hope that as a byproduct of this, when we've got an election over and the new government is able to look at these things more calmly, they can look to see how the Nationality Department actually works.
But after this, after Mr. Mandelson's resignation, you said, when he began to launch his defence, something very strange is going on inside Peter's head.
Well, that's my view.
Well, but surely as a after today, he's vindicated, his tactics are vindicated.
He's vindicated, and I repeat, because he hasn't lied, he hasn't intentionally deceived.
But so why was he sacked then?
He is sacked because he constantly calls this sort of embarrassment for the government. Remember, I wrote or said, I can't remember whether I wrote it or said it on a programme, if Mr. Mandelson didn't lie, day three, he lied about not lying, because at some point he admitted all the allegations against him. You can't have a cabinet minister who behaves in that way.
So, Anne Whittaker, how do you actually pursue this from now on?
Can I just say very quickly to Roy Hattersley, you really can't have it both ways. If this report is accurate, then Mandelson did not lie, and Labour ministers like Jack Straw and Clare Short have accused him of lying and should now retract that. But if there was something very strange going on, then we need to look to the body of the report and I think to raise questions.
What conclusion does Ms. Whittaker come to herself?
The conclusion that I come to is that there was certainly too high a degree of ministerial intervention in these applications. We were told by Mike O'Brien very early on in this saga that it was all left to officials.
Right.
The memoranda do not bear that out.
And Norman Baker, it does affect all parties, doesn't it? Because the network of people meeting the Hindujas included your leader, Charles Kennedy, who was at their Diwali party a couple of years ago.
I think there are serious questions about access, as Roy Hattersley says, access from the Hinduja brothers to key people in politics, and how that's been made possible. There are a number of lessons to be learned from the report, including, I think, a reworking of the Ministerial Code of Conduct. We saw, for example, as a side issue from this, Keith Vaz apparently using the Foreign Office to deal with a Soho restaurateur's insurance claim. Now, that sort of thing apparently is OK in the present Ministerial Code. It clearly isn't all right, I think, in terms of how the public see things. So I hope the Prime Minister will take the opportunity to tighten up the code. And one last point about this whole episode. It has been a mess.
Quickly.
There are lessons to be learned, but let's be under no illusions. What we've seen in the last few weeks is just a pale shadow of the sleaze we used to see under the Tories.
Mr. Baker, Ms. Whittaker, Lord Hattersley, thank you very much indeed. In a moment we'll discuss whether Mr. Mandelson can come back from this, but first, just a moment's reflection on what has been a rollercoaster month and a half for Mr. Blair's one-time closest ally.
I do not desire a return to government. There are more ways to serve New Labour and to fulfil our ambitions for the country. And that is what I intend to do. Thank you very much indeed.
So can Mr. Mandelson come back? To discuss that, I'm joined by George Jones of the Daily Telegraph and Andrew Rawnsley of the Observer. Come back, is it possible, George Jones?
Well, you must never say never in politics, but I think it is highly unlikely. I was struck today by how firm Tony Blair was trying to push the whole resignation into the past, saying that was over and done with, wouldn't be reopened, and that Peter Mandelson's career in government was over. possibly some role behind the scenes in the election, but I think it's into the next parliament that he'll have to look for some sort of rehabilitation in public life.
And yet he was restrained today, Peter Mandelson.
Yes, he was. There's only one case in history I can think of where somebody's left and returned to the cabinet three times in a row, and that's Winston Churchill, and it took a world war to bring him back. But you should never say never. There are a few members of the cabinet who regard it as not impossible. And it was very interesting, you put your finger on an interesting point there, Jeremy, the coincidence of the words and the language used by Tony Blair and Peter Mandelson. They were singing from so much from a similar hymn sheet that it suggests to me there has been some conversation between them, some sort of agreement, which of course they wouldn't share with the rest of us for a very long time, as to what Peter Mandelson's future might be. I certainly don't see it as being a Labour backbencher for 20 years. He's not a man to devote his time to unblocking council tenants' drains for the rest of his political
now,
career.
If there's a shape of something to come that isn't in Parliament, what would it be?
Well, Peter Mandelson has said he's going to contest the next election. He's got quite a fight on his hands in Hartlepool after what has happened. I mean, I think the big thing that Peter Mandelson can look forward to is, after the next election, the question of the euro, the referendum on the single currency. The whole leadership of the campaign for Britain in Europe is in total disarray. If Peter Mandelson could take control of that, perhaps bring the organisational, tactical skills he brought to the Labour Party, that could be a serious task for him, and that could then pave the way for him perhaps to go into Europe, a European commissioner. I think there is a European role for him.
I agree with George about that. He's commonly portrayed as nothing much but an opportunist by his enemies, but the one passionate conviction he's certainly always had and articulated is that he believes Britain's manifest destiny is in with Europe. But of course there are troubles there. If he takes a very high-profile role, it's going to bring him into antagonism, probably with his old antagonist, the Chancellor Gordon Brown, whose own paranoid streak may be inflamed if he gets the idea that Peter Mandelson is being encouraged, secretly or not, from within Number 10 by Tony Blair.
Do you think that Mr. Blair will regret this day, George?
It's been a damaging day for him, and I think his whole judgment, what happened at the Kangaroo Court, those events in Downing Street, the fact that he appeared to ignore the advice of his most senior civil servant, Sir Richard Wilson. But in the end, he's got what he wanted from this report, which was that the government has been cleared of any wrongdoing, any link between cash for passports and the dome. So I think that's what he's got. I think he'll hope that it'll be swept away as we go into a general election and that he won't suffer sort of long-standing damage from it.
And as you say, Andrew, they seem to be on, Mr. Blair and Mr. Mandelson seem to be on the same kind of frequency today, strangely, so revenge is ruled out then?
Well, broadly, it's good for the government in that it's not so much a whitewash as a great dollop of magnolia emulsion that's been spread all over the government. And I don't think, as they're sitting in the frock and ferret or wherever floating voters go, I don't think people are going to sit around saying, oh, that Tony Blair should have never shafted Peter Mandelson so disgracefully, I'm now going to go and vote Tory. I don't think that happens. But at a subtler level, it's bad for the Prime Minister because it does raise questions about his judgment, why Peter Mandelson was sacked if he actually had done nothing wrong. And out there among Labour MPs, they may see if the Prime Minister, in a hysterical panic inside Number 10, is prepared to sacrifice his oldest and closest ally, what might he do to us? And that alters subtly the complex power balance between Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. People may think, well, we might be safer with Gordon long term.
Andrew Rawnsley, George Jones, thank you both very much indeed. In a moment, Newsnight Review, but first a roundup of today's headlines. Peter Mandelson has ruled out a return to government despite being cleared of wrongdoing over the Hinduja passport affair. An inquiry by Sir Anthony Hammond found that neither Mr. Mandelson nor the Minister for Europe, Keith Vaz, had exerted improper pressure on the Home Office to grant passports to the wealthy Hinduja brothers. 20 new cases of foot and mouth disease were confirmed today, the highest daily increase since the outbreak began. The total number of cases now stands at 127. The Ministry of Agriculture has agreed to lift some restrictions to allow animals in areas free from the disease to be moved short distances. The badminton horse trials have become the latest sporting event to be cancelled. A police officer who was praised in the report into Stephen Lawrence's murder has been charged with raping a black woman. Sergeant Peter Solly, who was awarded the MBE last year for outstanding service, appeared in court on 9 counts of rape. He's also accused of committing perjury during the Lawrence inquiry. A judge in Florida has sentenced a 14-year-old American boy to life in prison without parole for killing a 6-year-old girl. Lionel Tate's lawyer had argued that he hadn't meant to kill the girl. He was just playing at wrestling with her. The prosecutor argued a reduced sentence would be more appropriate. And the markets, the FT 100 share index was down, while in New York, the Dow Jones was heavily down. Against the pound, the euro was up slightly, and against the dollar, sterling was also up slightly. I'll be back with the newspaper front pages later, but now it's over to Mark Lawson for Newsnight Review.
Hello. Three critics discuss four subjects, which tonight are... The fifth installment of novelist John Updike's study of an American slob over 40 years. Art or exploitation? Police order the removal of pictures of children from a leading gallery. Anthea Turner and Vanessa Feltz in One Bathroom, the surreal world of Celebrity Big Brother. Love Me, Love My Dog, owners who resemble their pets in Best in Show.
To think that in some countries these dogs are eaten.
And this week's trio of pedigree critics are Ian Hislop, editor of Private Eye magazine, Professor Germaine Greer, author of The Female Eunuch and The Whole Woman, and the journalist and broadcaster Echo Eschen. Since Peter Mandelson resigned from the cabinet, his main public appearances have involved walking his dogs and catching up on the latest movies. This weekend, there's a chance for the politician in limbo to combine both leisure interests, as the big film release is about dog owners. Best in Show is written and directed by Christopher Guest, who's partly responsible for the 1983 hit This Is Spinal Tap, a spoof documentary about a rock band. In style, Best in Show drinks from the same bowl, but the target here is various American couples, covering the full range of sexual possibilities, who converge on the Mayflower Dog Show in Philadelphia like stage mothers with puppies instead of children.
With Sherry Ann, we have this fantastic friendship, too. It's really great. And we have a little bit of a family dynamic going here, and it pretty much mirrors what I grew up with, you know. My father was the taskmaster, the disciplinarian, which is what I do. I'm the mommy slash daddy. That's right.
Like Mr. Punishment.
Oh, well, you know, and also reward. Mm. But Sherry's responsible for the unconditional love, you know.
And the decorative abilities.
Exactly, the heart and the soul, you know, which is what my mother did, and that was her job. You know, she was there for the unconditional love. Mm. And it worked for my family, you know, until my mom committed suicide in 81.
Best in Show. Ian Hislop, Guest had a good subject in rock bands. That worked. What about dog shows? Does that work satirically?
Yeah, I thought it was very funny. I mean, satirically maybe overstating it, but it's a very funny film. It's very charming. And he does the same improvisation pretending to be a mock documentary. And it's beautifully observed. The characters are great. And the big finale, the dog show, has two fantastic commentators, which I think is one of the funniest things I've seen as an attempt to portray really sort of feeble television commentary on a dog show. There's one Englishman, probably from Horse and Hound or something, trying to be serious about dogs, and what looks like a retired sports presenter who's got no interest in dogs at all,
and he's
trying to pep it up.
The same metaphors.
Well, he either does it as football or tries to get sex in. It is very funny. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a great, fun film. Satire's pushing it, but it's a very good description of a group of people who love their dogs.
Germaine Greer, who's somebody who loves her dogs. With Spinal Tap, most people knew a bit about rock bands, probably quite a lot when they watched it. Most people don't know very much about dog owners. Did this feel accurate to you?
Well, it's accurate to a point, except that I found the jokes tremendously overdrawn. There's nobody who has a Weimaraner who doesn't know that you don't scream and shout and carry on in front of the dog and then expect the dog to be calm. It was wonderful when the dog attacked the judge. The only thing you've been longing for was the dog to eat both its stupid owners, who both, for some reason, had their teeth in bands. They had orthodontistry, which was making some kind of American point about them. I mean, I was bothered because all the couples, or all the dog owners, were stereotyped one way or another, and there was only one joke in each case. And this film reiterated that joke until you could weep for boredom. So that one man has two left feet and a wife who has been bald by everybody south of the North Pole. And so we get told every time she appears, the guy who enters the interchange is one of the men who's had sex with her. Okay, once, okay, twice, okay, maybe three times. But by the end of the film, you were saying, now, come on, there has to be a better joke. And they couldn't make a joke of the dog show itself. And one other...
Yes, they did. They filled the dog show with good jokes.
Dog shows are ridiculous and tragic
and they made
at the
it
same
ridiculous.
Time.
Well,
but they're much bigger than that. And the dogs weren't good enough, I have to
we
tell
We can't
you.
Allow a dog owner to dominate this. Echo Eschen,
I'm not a dog owner. I should put up my hand and say that. But I thought it was very funny. But that doesn't mean it was flawless. It's not flawless because I think its strength is actually its weakness in that it's all improvised and the whole film, actually, most of it is shot on a first take basis. And what that means is that the actors have to transcend their characters, and their characters are stereotypes. And sometimes that works. That actually works in terms of Christopher Guest, the director, who plays this kind of hang-doggy southern old boy called Harlan Pepper, who's got this old hound dog who's kind of lopes around. And he's a great character. Doesn't work in the case of Parker Posey, who's one of these neurotic lawyers that Jermaine's talking about, who are kind of uptight, screechy, who overplay rather than underplay. Very difficult to have sympathy for their characters.
Because if we talk about what happens with improvisation, it sometimes happens with Mike Leigh's films. If you ask actors to build up a character, they will take some kind of silly voice, or they'll take dental bands, and you get the risk as a caricature.
Well, exactly. See, the whole point is that what happens is we end up having a lot of sympathy for these characters. They are absurd. They are ridiculous. There's nothing wrong with that. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. The whole point of a dog show is ridiculous. It's overplayed. But the point is, this isn't really satire in the Guest isn't trying to ridicule his characters. He's actually trying to bring out the warmth and the emotion of them. That's why some of those characters work. That's why in the case of Parker Posey, the neurotic lawyers with braces, it doesn't work.
Ian Hislop, isn't there a problem that, I mean, very funny, I agree with you, but every set of characters, the dogs are substitute children. I mean, that joke applies in every case. They could have varied it a little, couldn't they?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think they had to. The jokes worked perfectly well. It's no good saying I wanted to see some other jokes. Those are the ones he chose to give you. I mean, it's very serious for me. I've judged dog shows in my time at Fates, and it's a very great responsibility, choosing which dog and owner win. And I think that the basic joke of that situation was done terribly well.
When the documentary joke was done in This Is Spinal Tap, it was quite new. I mean, there are now spoof documentaries, cinema and TV every couple of weeks. I mean, does he have anything new to bring to that, Echo?
Well, see, the point is, this isn't only a kind of mockumentary. It's also what it really parodises is actually Hollywood films in themselves. It parodises the little guy who makes it big at the end of a movie to the swelling tunes of a big orchestra. So in the final dog show moments of the film, which are brilliant, which are really, really funny, I was reminded of Rocky. I was reminded of Raging Bull. I was reminded of all of these things where the little guy has to summon his courage and really beat down the forces of oppression that have held him down all the way through this film. And what's really great here is that it manages to do this without most of the tricks, most of the artifice.
Throughout this praise
film.
From both sides, Jermaine was looking like a
black hand
and hasn't had its supper, so Jermaine.
It overdid every single joke. The girlfriend falls over.
Jermaine, they were
jolly
funny.
So she walks with a leg that it sticks out the wrong way. He has two left feet. So what do we have? We have him with two left feet.
Yeah, that joke is made once at the beginning of the film and once at the end as a reprise. It's funny both times. You're watching a different film.
No, I'm watching the same film, except it wasn't very funny the first time.
We're going to leave it there. Sharp-eyed viewers have noticed that one of the arms of Jermaine's spectacles has gone. The dog ate it, apparently, so that may have influenced her. Rosettes from two of the three judges for Best in Show, which opens at selected cinemas around the country today. We move on to a news story which may provoke the biggest debate about artistic freedom and official censorship in Britain since the attempted prosecution for obscenity of the National Theatre play The Romans in Britain in 1981. Officers from the police, clubs and vice squad have visited the Saatchi Gallery in Hampstead, London, after complaints about pictures on display there by the 37-year-old American photographer Tierney Gearan. The objections concern a series of photographs of Gearan's young children, aged 4 and 7 when most of the pictures were taken. They're shown naked and wearing masks, and in one case the boy is